steamer began to move slowly away, but on the landward horizon appeared the silhouette of a fighting machine. Another came, and another, striding over hills and trees, plunging far out to sea and blocking the exit of the steamer. Between them lay the silent, grey, ironclad Thunder Child. Slowly it moved toward shore, then with a deafening roar and whoosh of spray, it swung about and drove at full speed towards the waiting Martians.
There were ships of shapes and sizes scattered out along the bay, and I thought I heard her calling as the steamer pulled away. The invaders must have seen them as across the coast they filed, standing from between them. There lay Thunder Child, moving swiftly through the waters, cannons blazing as she came. Brought a mighty vessel warlord crashing down in sheets of flame. Sensing victory was nearing, thinking fortune must have smiled, people started cheering. Come on, Thunder Child, come on, Thunder Child.
The Martians released their black smoke, but the ship sped on, cutting down one of the tripod figures. Instantly, the others raised their heat rays and melted the Thunder Child's valiant heart. Smoke cleared, the little steamer had reached the misty horizon and Carrie was safe. But the Thunder Child had vanished forever, taking with her man's last hope of victory. The leaden sky was lit by green flashes, cylinder following cylinder, and no one and nothing was left now to fight them. The Earth belonged to the Martians. Next day, the dawn was a brilliant fiery red, and I wandered through the weird and lurid landscape of another planet, for the vegetation which gives Mars its red appearance had taken root on Earth. As man had succumbed to the Martians, so our land now succumbed to the red weed. Choking the movement of the water. And then it began to creep like a slimy red animal across the land, covering field and ditch and tree and hedgerow with living scarlet feelers, crawling, crawling. Body of a parson lying on the ground in a ruined churchyard. I felt unable to leave him to the mercy of the red weed and decided to bury him decently.
Nathaniel! Nathaniel!
The parson's eyes flickered open. He was alive.
Burst into flame. Are you all right?
Don't touch me.
But it's me, Beth. Your wife.
No, you're one of them. A devil.
He's delirious.
Lies! I saw the devil's sign.
What are you saying?
The green flash in the sky. His demons were here all along, in our hearts and souls, just waiting for a sign from him. And now they're destroying our world.
But they're not devils. They're Martians.
We must leave here.
Look, the house still standing. Come, Nathaniel, quickly.
We took shelter in a cottage, and black smoke spread, hemming us in. Then a fighting machine came across the field, spraying jets of steam that turned the smoke into thick, black dust.
Dear God, help us!
The voice of the devil is heard in our land! Listen, do you hear them drawing near in their search for the sinners? Feeding on the power of our fear and the evil within us. Incarnation of Satan's creation of all that we dread. When the demons arrive, those alive would be better off dead.
There must be something worth living for. There must be something worth trying for. Even something's worth dying for. And if one man can stand tall, there must be hope for us all. Somewhere, somewhere in the spirit of man.
Once there was a time when I believed without hesitation that the power of love and truth could conquer all in the name of salvation. Tell me, what kind of weapon is love when it comes to the fight? And just how much protection is truth against all Satan's might?
There must be something worth living for. There must be something worth trying for. Even something's worth dying for. And if one man can stand tall, there must be some hope for us all. Somewhere, somewhere in the spirit of man. Loved you and trusted you, came to you for help.
Didn't I warn them this would happen? Be on your guard, I said.
for the evil one never rests. I said, exorcise the devil! But no, they wouldn't listen. The demons inside them grew and grew until Satan gave his signal and destroyed the world we knew.
No, Nathaniel. Oh, no, Nathaniel. No, Nathaniel, no. There must be more to life. There has to be a way that we can restore.
Thank you.
has landed on the house, and we're underneath it, in the pit.
The Martians spent the night making a new machine. It was a squat, metallic spider with huge, articulated claws. But it, too, had a hood in which a Martian sat. I watched it pursuing some people across a field. It caught them nimbly and tossed them into a great metal basket upon its back.
Beth? She's dead! Buried under the rubble! Why? Satan, why did you take one of your own? On mankind, we may as well be resigned to let the devil take the spirit of man.
Time passed in our dark and dusty prison. The parson wrestled endlessly with his doubts. His outcries invited death for us both. And yet, I pitied him. Day, we saw the Martians eating. Inside the hood of their new machine, they were draining the fresh, living blood of men and women and injecting it into their own veins.
It's a sign! I've been given a sign! They must be cast out! And I have been chosen to do it! I must confront them now!
No, Parson, no!
Those machines are just demons in another form! I shall destroy them with my prayers. I shall burn them with my holy cross. I shall...
The curious eye of a Martian appeared at the window slit, and a menacing claw explored the room. I dragged the parson down to the coal cellar. I heard the Martian fumbling at the latch. In the darkness, I could see the claw touching things. Walls, coal, wood. And then it touched my boot. I almost shouted. For a time it was still, and then, with a click, it gripped something. The parson, with slow, deliberate movements, his unconscious body was dragged away, and there was nothing I could do to prevent it.
Thank you.
crept to the blocked window slit and peered through the creeper. The Martians and all their machinery had gone. Trembling, I dug my way out and clambered to the top of the mound. Not a Martian in sight. The day seemed dazzling bright after my imprisonment, and the sky a glowing blue. Red weed covered every scrap of ground, but a gentle breeze kept it swaying. And oh, the sweetness of the air. And villages that were black and ruins, totally silent, desolate, deserted. Man's empire had passed away, taken swiftly and without error by these creatures who were composed entirely of brain. Unhampered by the complex systems which make up man, they made and used different bodies according to their needs. They never tired, never slept, and never suffered, having long since eliminated from their planet bacteria which cause all fevers and other morbidities.